What's up, Cornerstone Christian Church? Super excited that you have joined us here online for our online experience of worship. We got some awesome announcements before we get into our worship. So here they are. We're going to be re-gathering August 23rd. So next Sunday, we will be meeting in person. Super pumped about that. We hope that you are too. If you have any questions about the re-gathering, any things that might happen with that, please reach out to Kent Hawkins. His number is on the screen behind me. If you don't have it, get it, and let him know if you'll be attending. So we know how many chairs to set up, and we can just kind of foresee what the attendance will be. So make sure to reach out to Kent. But Ascend, one of my favorite things that happens here at Cornerstone is hanging out with our youth students. And I'm excited to hang out with them next week in person. But for tonight, make sure that you watch the video online and that you join us on the Zoom link at 6:30. We would love to see your students there. Another thing that we're doing for our students is we're going to do a drive-by party. We're going to do a drive-by back-to-school party for our teens. It's going to be Friday, August 21st from 6 to 7 p.m. We got some goodies for your teens, for your middle school, high schooler, and we're going to pray over them just as they go into the new school year. So make sure that you are prepared for that. But there's more that happens here at Cornerstone. We've got kids that go to church here, and they love going here. We have right now some videos that they can watch online to stay connected. They'll have Miss Tabby or me do a lesson, and they can join in on that. But we have more for our kids. We have our kids' books reading that happen every single Monday at 5:30. You can watch these as a family. You can give your phone to your kiddo to watch the book being read. But we encourage you to take some time and enjoy some quality time with your kiddos. But like I said, we got a lot of stuff that's happened here at Cornerstone. And this last week that we're going to be in this corona break, we'll have daily devotions posted. You can watch them at 6 p.m. on one of the four websites. So we really encourage you to watch those. They are always super encouraging. So make sure that you watch them. Now, this happens to be my personal favorite announcement because it's the Stone Show. If you didn't watch it last week and you didn't watch it this week, make sure that you watch it this upcoming week. It's an awesome time. You can enjoy some comic relief from me, the host, Joey Tosilla. And that happens 7 p.m. on Fridays. So don't miss it. It's going to be awesome. Another way that you can connect here at Cornerstone is by a giving. We know that our members here at Cornerstone are faithful, faithful givers. We are so thankful for that. You can give one of these three ways. But right now is the moment that we've been waiting for all week. We get to worship our Lord and Savior. Would you do that with us this morning?
And we're going to ask everyone, wherever you are at, to please stand with us, because it's easier to sing when you're standing up. This is a great promise from God that we are chosen, we're not forsaken, we are a child of God. So sing along with us.
I'm a child of God, yes I am. A am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Till the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
Psalm 103, the psalmist talks about how high the heavens are from the earth. That's how much God loves us. And how far the east is from the west. That's how far he's thrown our sins. And so we remember how great God's love is. That through our trials, through our circumstances, through everything going on around us, that God's love is greater than it all. That even when we can't see him, he loves us. And his love is enough for us in everything we do.
together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good.
Weeks ago, we had a sermon series based upon the Godhead, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we introduced this song. It's not new to the public, but it was newer to our congregation. So sing along with us as we talk about the beauty of God's Holy Spirit that resides in each and every one of us.
Your goodness, let us become more.
Psalm 130, the psalmist talks about how if the Lord counted how many times we'd sin, no one would be able to stand against him, but that through his forgiveness, we are free to serve him, and that through his forgiveness, we do that with adoration and reverence, and that forgiveness is found through the blood of Jesus Christ. And so as we come to this time of communion, as we come to this communion song, we remember how great God's forgiveness is, and how through Jesus' blood, by faith, we can all receive that forgiveness no matter what we've done.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Leave the sorrows and trade them. From the ashes in my life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are
altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with
There used to be a saying that went like this. In spring, a young man's thoughts turn to romance. For me as a young boy, in spring, my thoughts turned to baseball. When I was in the fifth grade, I wanted to play Little League Baseball, but I had a problem. I didn't have a baseball glove. My birthday was in the first week of May, and I remember going to my dad and said, "Dad, I want to play baseball this year and practice begins real soon. But I don't have a baseball glove." His answer was, "Son, I know that." On my birthday, he gave me a brand new baseball glove. You know, the more I've thought about that since, I bet my dad already had that baseball glove hiding somewhere in a closet just ready to give to me on my birthday. Our Heavenly Father knows all of our needs. He knew before the world began that every one of us would sin and thus would need a Savior. He already had a plan. And listen to what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 5. Get this first sentence. "You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. For very rarely would anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." We all sin, and we all need a Savior. And that's why, at just the right time, God sent his Son as a human being to be sacrificed for our sins. Today, as we all sit in our homes, we can be together spiritually as we remember what Jesus did to pay for our sins. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, as we hold this little piece of bread, this loaf in our hands, and this cup, we remember that you sent your Son to die even before we needed a Savior. The plan was already in place. And we thank you for that, O God. We know that Jesus suffered much on that cross when he gave his life for us. His body was broken, his blood was shed. And through that act, we all can be forgiven of our sins. Thank you for that. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
We begin today our third week of the series called Fearless, based upon Max Lucado's book of the same title. And today the fear that we're looking at is the fear of disappointing God. Speaking of disappointing, a pet owner brought her pet duck Cuddles into the veterinarian, and she laid the very sick duck out on the veterinarian table, and the vet came in and got his stethoscope out and began to check the chest of this very sick bird. And in a few minutes later, he took the stethoscope off and just kind of sadly shook his head and said, I'm sorry, but your pet duck Cuddles has died. The woman protested and said, well, how do you know for sure? I mean, you've not run any tests. You've not checked blood or anything like that. Maybe the bird's just in a coma. The vet kind of rolled his eyes and left the room for a moment. And a couple minutes later, he returned to the examining room with a black Labrador retriever. As the woman looked on in astonishment, the lab jumped up on the table with its front paws and began to sniff the bird from head to toe, and then sadly shook his head with sad eyes and just went. The vet pat the dog on the head, and the dog walked out of the room. And a few minutes later, a tabby cat comes in and immediately jumps up on the table and delicately begins to sniff the bird from head to toe, and again sits back on his haunches and then with very sadly just kind of meowed. And the vet again patted the cat, and the cat strolled out of the room. Well, the veterinarian looked at the woman and just simply said, listen, I'm sorry, but here's the confirmation. This is 100% certifiably a dead duck. Well, the woman just burst into tears. And as she was crying, the vet turned around to his computer and began to print out a bill. And he handed it to the woman, and the woman, who was still in shock, looked at the bill and said, $150? You're charging me $150 just to tell me that my pet duck Cuddles is dead? And the vet said, well, if you would have taken my word for it, it would have only been $20, but then you asked for a lab report and a CAT scan. I'm waiting for the laughter to die down in each of the rooms of your homes there. And no, I'm not sorry I told you that story. Well, we're talking about, again, the fear of disappointing. During the first week, we asked the question, why are we so afraid? And if you remember, we were looking at the event of Jesus on the Sea of Galilee and how the storm arose and the apostles were scared and they asked Jesus to save them. And we've got to understand that just like the apostles had Jesus literally in their boat, we have Jesus in the boat of our lives, and He always can calm our storms. Last week, we talked about the fear of not mattering. And I get it. The world may look at each of us and say, you don't really have much value. You don't matter, at least to us. But I will tell you, that's not how God feels about you. No, God values you because He made you and because He loves you. And so today we turn to our next subject, and that's the fear of disappointing God. And the question we're going to ask today is, can we really be forgiven of our pasts, of all the mistakes, of all the sins of our life? Would you please give your attention to Max as he starts us out today?
For such a sweet dog, my dog Molly sure has a defiant streak. Let her nose catch the whiff of a neighbor's grilling steak, her uncovered trash can, and man, she just disappears. You don't want to know how many times this minister has run down his street shouting unminister-like warnings to his pet. Well, not long ago, we thought we had lost her for good. We posted pictures all over the neighborhood. We called friends. I finally drove over to the animal shelter, and I described the situation to the director, and she pointed me to a building, a barracks-shaped building, that had this sign on the front, Stray Dogs. Warning to all soft-hearted dog lovers, don't go in there. It'll break your heart. One cage after another of lost dogs. All sad eyes, different breeds, different sizes, different colors, different shapes. But what they had in common? Lost as blind geese with no clue how to get home. I didn't find Molly in the kennel, but I had the craziest urge in the kennel. I had the urge to go from door to door, from cage to cage, opening each one, shouting, "Be of good cheer. You're lost no longer. Come home with me." I didn't do it, because though the urge was great, and though I loved the dogs, I loved to be married even more, and I knew that wouldn't go over too well. But still, I had the urge, and the urge helped me understand why Jesus made his first call to courage a call to accept his forgiveness. That's right. His first call to courage is within the context of grace. There are over 21 times in Scripture that Jesus calls us to courage, but the first one is in a sentence about his forgiveness. Some people brought a man to Jesus who was paralyzed, and when Jesus saw the faith of these people who brought their friend to Jesus, here's what Jesus said to the man. He said, "Take courage, son. Your sins are forgiven." Now note, Jesus places courage and forgiveness in the same sentence in this, his first call to valor, as if bravery begins with God's grace. You see, all of us have pulled a Molly. All of us have turned away from our Master. All of us have ignored His commands. We have disappointed God. But even though we have disappointed God, God has not abandoned us. Over and over and over, we are assured that God's grace is abundant for us all. And this is call for courage. Listen to the certainty with which Scripture writers describe God's forgiveness. Paul says, "We are delivered from the power of darkness and conveyed into the kingdom of God." John says, "He who believes in Him is not condemned." Jesus said, "Everyone who looks to the Son and believes in Him shall have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in the last day." And John later wrote, "These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life." Jesus loves you too much to leave you living in the shadow of doubt. The Bible says that God's perfect love expels all fear. If God didn't have perfect love, we would have reason to fear, because fear keeps a list of wrongs and consults it often. But God loves us with a perfect love. And His love casts out fear because He casts out our sin. As Paul told Titus, God's readiness to give and forgive is now public. Salvation is available for everyone. Tell them all this and build up their courage. You see, courage comes when we know that God has forgiven us. Nothing fosters courage like a clear grasp of God's grace. And yet, nothing fosters fear like misunderstanding about God's mercy. Can I ask you a candid question? Have you accepted God's forgiveness? If you're living in a shadow of doubt, you're going to live in fear all of your life. Because down deep in your heart, you know that you have turned away from your Master and you have rebelled against Him. And nothing, no pill, no psychiatrist, no pop therapy, no possession, nothing can set the sinner's heart at ease except the grace of God. Why don't you just ask God to forgive you? Did you know that the Bible says that His forgiveness is open to any person? Here's what Scripture says. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Your prayer can be as simple as this. Dear Father, I admit that I have turned away from You. I ask for Your forgiveness. I accept Your grace, and I trust Your love for me. Through Jesus I pray. Amen. It's as simple as that. By the way, The case of the missing Molly, we found her in a neighbor's backyard. Turns out she wasn't as far from home as we feared. You aren't either.
Now, I understand that this fear of disappointing God is probably not a fear that impacts the world, but it does us. Because we as Christians, we want to please God. And we understand that our sin, well, it's the opposite of that. Time after time, we don't measure up to God's standards, that we somehow disappoint Him by the way we live. This fear may be even stronger than the fear of death. Let me explain it this way. We as Christians, we believe in a literal heaven and a literal hell. We believe that's what's the truth after this life. And we want to go to heaven, but Satan often kind of coerces us and makes us think that because of our sins and because of our mistakes, then, well, we're not going to do that. We're going to have too many bad deeds in our life. In fact, he tries to convince us that when judgment day comes, that we're going to be counted amongst the goats rather than the sheep. See, we think that God is one or two things. We think that he's either like Santa Claus, and of course Santa has the naughty list and the nice list, and then we have to do enough good deeds to stay on the good list and keep our bad deeds lower than that. Otherwise, we're going to receive the eternal lump of coal, which is hell. And of course, we know that coal burns. This wrong concept, though, is always about us. It's about what I do. It's about earning my own salvation. It's being good enough to deserve heaven, which, of course, we can't. But the second thing we can think a wrong concept is at the end of our lives, we're going to stand before God in that huge judgment hall where millions of people have gathered, and we're going to stand before this gigantic LED TV screen, and all of our sins, our life is going to be cast up on that, and we're going to hang our head in shame as we have to relive every single mistake that we've ever made, and all the people in the world are going to see that. I believe we have some of these wrong concepts and wrong ideas because we do not fully comprehend God's grace and God's forgiveness. We sometimes wonder to ourselves, we said, does God really forgive and forget our sins? Or does he secretly have a list that he files away and then he's going to bring that list out on judgment day? We reason to ourselves, well, God's grace is like a well, and it's got to have a bottom to it someplace. It's got to have a bottom at some point. Or we think that God's grace and mercy is like a bank, and that we take out deposits as we need them. But at some point, if we take out enough mercy advances, one of those is going to bounce. One of those is going to bounce. I want you to understand that God's grace is not like that. Did you like Max's story about his pet dog, Molly? I appreciated that. We had two dogs over the course of our married life. Barkley was our first dog, and then Diesel was our second dog. I will tell you that I appreciated Barkley much more than Diesel. But Diesel escaped out of our house two or three different times over the 15 years we had them. But one was the most strange occasion. So it's during a hurricane, and I know that some of you won't believe this, but I was spending some quality time with my dog out on the porch, all right? And we were just kind of listening to the wind and watching the rain as it was blowing horizontally past the porch. Well, it had been a few hours since Diesel had been out, and I thought, well, he probably needs to go outside. We have an oak tree that's literally 6 feet from the door of our porch to the tree. And so I open the door to let him out, and he takes off. But not towards the tree, of course. He takes off towards the street, the front of the yard. And yeah, I had to put on my rain poncho, and I'm braving these 150-mile-an-hour gusts, and I'm looking for Diesel for 10 to 15 minutes. And I finally find Diesel, and he's sitting on the door stoop of our next-door neighbor. Now, please understand that he never goes over to that house, and number two, it's not protected. And so he's sitting there shivering and scared as the wind is beating against him and the rain is pelting his little body. Now, I shouldn't say that Diesel wasn't really intelligent, but if they had a short bus for dogs, he certainly would have ridden that bus. Now, I wonder, why do dogs and cats stray? Why do they leave the security of our home? Maybe it's simply curiosity, you know, that kills the cat. Maybe it's they think they can find something better to eat somewhere else. Maybe they think that someone is going to be a better caretaker of them. Yeah, in Diesel's situation, that wouldn't be hard for me. And he probably was looking for someone that might treat him with a little more affection and love. See, we too are prone to stray, just like a dog or cat does. And like the prodigal son, we think that somehow something is better out there in the world than having a relationship with our Heavenly Father. Oh, the prodigal son, he sought fun and excitement, but all he found was sorrow and regret. Every one of us has wandered away, and we do that from time to time, and some of us have taken some pretty long journeys off the righteous and narrow path. And I understand that when that happens, when we stray, we might think, okay, well, God will forgive me, but what about when I stray for the second and third and fourth and fifth time, or for the 100th time or the 1,000,000th time? Can God really forgive me? I mean, we reason to ourselves, isn't there this point that God looks at us and says, all right, enough is enough. I've had all I can stands and I can't stands no more. You've pushed me too far. You've gone too far. You're on your own. Goodbye. And slams the door on us, spiritually speaking. Maybe you think you've ticked God off so much and so often, so deeply, that there's no way that God can possibly forgive your sin. And so we ask the question, can we disappoint God? Can we disappoint Him to the point where He finally disowns us? And the answer is an emphatic no. Now, we don't sin that grace may abound. That's what Romans tells us. But folks, Jesus will always search for us. The prodigal son's story is such an amazing one because the Father, who represents the Heavenly Father, He's always vigilant. He's always searching, always looking all around the horizon. He's always hoping and desiring and pleading that His Son might come home once again. And our Heavenly Father is just like that, always wanting us to come back. 2 weeks ago, we were reading from Matthew chapter 8, and it was the story of Jesus on the Sea of Galilee and the storm that came up. Right before that event, during that same day, Jesus had healed about 3 different people. And right after the storm on the sea, He heals someone else. But along with this physical healing, we've got a really cool spiritual lesson. Look with me at Matthew chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. Here's the event. It says, Jesus stepped into a boat and crossed over and came to His own town. Some men brought to Him a paralyzed man lying on a mat. And when Jesus saw their faith, He said to the man, take heart, son, your sins are forgiven. Now, this is the very first time that Jesus ever tells someone specifically, don't fear. Don't have any fear. I think what's the most interesting thing is that Jesus places courage and forgiveness, and He puts those two things together. Look at that text. He places courage and forgiveness together. See, there's an additional lesson here that Jesus teaches us that when we solve the sin problem as Jesus forgives our sin, then we don't have to fear any longer. We are receiving the courage we need. But of course, conversely, a life that's full of sin, it's always going to be filled with fear. And so in this instance, there's this huge crowd that's gathered. They're listening to Jesus. These guys with their friend on the mat, they can't get in to see Jesus. And so Mark's gospel tells us that they go up on the roof. They're not deterred. They rip a hole in the roof and they let their friend down on maybe some cords or something right in front of Jesus. Now, I'll tell you that most homeowners, they don't like holes ripped in their roof. And most lame people probably don't like bungee jumping from the second story of a house. And most teachers don't like to be interrupted while they're speaking, but of course not Jesus. He's filled with empathy. He's impressed with these men, and He pronounces a blessing on them, and then He says something completely amazing. He forgives this man's sin. He forgave his sins. Now I want you to look at the reaction in verse 3. Because at this, it says, some of the teachers of the law said to themselves, this fellow is blaspheming. In other words, only God can forgive sins, and they didn't think that Jesus was God, and so he is a blasphemer. See, men, this man, this lame man, his limbs were like spaghetti, but Jesus doesn't initially say, I'm going to give you muscles. Jesus says, I'm going to show you mercy. That's where he goes to first. And in doing this, Jesus was answering that deeper fear, this fear of the failing of God, the fear of disappointing God. And I understand it. This man was lame. Everyone could see that. Everyone knew that. That was the evident physical ailment. But Jesus, he could see way deeper into this man's soul, into his heart itself. And he saw the fear of sin. He saw the fear of disappointment. So immediately what does Jesus do? He reaches out. He says, I'm going to forgive your sins and release you from that fear. And maybe there's someone that's watching this service right now. And that's exactly where you're at. You've cried out for forgiveness. But the stains of your sin have left you paralyzed with fear. We've got to be able to grasp the truth of God's grace and His forgiveness. And I believe that when we do that, well, then we will find the courage we need to live a life on God's terms and not our own. Then I believe that we can realize that God is not against us. God is for us. Listen to what Paul said in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. For He has rescued us. He's rescued us from the dominion of darkness, and He's brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves. You know, like an owner of a dog or a cat or another pet that goes astray, that goes missing, God does not abandon us. No, He searches the neighborhood. He calls out our name. He prints billboards with our picture saying, have you seen my child? He will never abandon us or forsake us. He will never leave us, as the scripture says. Twice while I was growing up, I threw a baseball through a window of my house. On both occasions, I was disciplined. But in neither of those situations, even the second time I did it, did my parents abandon me. And every parent here would say the same thing. You don't abandon your children when they flood the bathtub or when they disobey you or when they get that first bad grade or when you find a dirty magazine under their bed or their mattress. You don't abandon them when they have their first car accident or when they rebel against your rules. And folks, if we as imperfect parents don't abandon our children when they hurt us and disappoint us, then how much more will God never abandon us because He is our perfect Heavenly Father? Do you think that God would abandon us for much less? Oh no, God loves us way too much. When we sin, God is definitely disappointed, but God will never, ever abandon us. When we ask, God forgives. And when He does forgive us, here's three things that happen. Number one, God will never remember that act again. In other words, He will never bring it up. He will never throw that back in our face. Do you remember when you... No, it's gone. But secondly, when God forgives us, He releases from this sentence of guilt. In other words, we are no longer guilty of the crime because He's forgiven us. And number three, God's forgiveness, it reconciles us as sinners, we understand that, to our holy and perfect God. He no longer treats us as a sinner because He's forgiven our sin. So the question is, do you believe this type of forgiveness? He will not abandon you. He has not abandoned you. Oh, I understand things you may have done, but He will not abandon you even though you have lied. And He has not abandoned you even though you have done something that you've never told anyone in your entire life. He will not abandon you even if you've committed adultery. He won't abandon you even if you've embezzled from your own business. He has not abandoned you even if, again, the actions have caused someone else to physically die. He will not abandon you even in your sexual sin. He will not abandon you if you were not a good parent or a good child. He will not abandon you even if you've cheated on your taxes or gotten drunk or you've dabbled in the occult. God will not abandon you. God can and God will forgive every sin. Every broken promise you've made to God, every sin you've committed, all of those things were nailed to the cross along with Jesus, the Son, the perfect Lamb of God. Everything that speaks against you is now silenced in light of Jesus' shed blood. And so we've been set free. And so you've got to let go of those past things that He's forgiven, because there is no price that has been paid anymore. Jesus has paid it all. And we are now released. Next, Jesus loves us, and he loves us too much to leave us in doubt about his grace. God wrote these next words. I'm going to read several verses because he wanted us to understand how unimportant it was for us to comprehend the grace that he's extended to each of us. And so John 3, verse 18 says, "Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." And of course, that's Jesus. John 6, verse 40 says, "For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last days." Add to that 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God." Why? "So that you may know that you have eternal life." And 1 John 4, 18, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear." Why? "Because fear has to do with punishment, but the one who fears is not made perfect in love." Oh, if God loved with an imperfect love, then we would have a reason to doubt and to be concerned and to worry. You see, imperfect love, it keeps a list of sins. It consults that list on occasion. But God keeps no list of wrongdoings. No, his love casts out our sin, and therefore he casts out the fear that we may have. And so what do we need to do, Christian brothers and sisters? We need to tether our hearts to his promise. To tether our heart to his promise. When you feel unforgiven, you need to evict those feelings. Because your feelings of worry and doubt about the lack of God's forgiveness, they don't matter. They aren't true at all. You see, we've got to go back to the Bible, God's Word, because that is the greater power than any of the feelings and emotions that you and I will ever have. Nothing fosters courage like a clear grasp of grace. Listen to what Paul said in Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and 15. "For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people." And verse 15, "These then are the things that you should teach, encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you." Since we know of the grace of God, we can love boldly and we can live robustly. We can jump from trapeze bar to trapeze bar because we know we have the safety net of God's grace that will catch us when we do fall. For again, nothing fosters courage like a clear grasp of God's grace. Conversely, nothing fosters more fear than being ignorant of God's grace. Here's the last thing I want to focus on, and that is without God's forgiveness, we are doomed to fear. Think about this. If we haven't accepted God's forgiveness, if God's grace, then you're going to be doomed to fear. I mean, nothing you can do in this life is going to take away that fear. There's no pill, there's no psychiatrist, there's no pep talk. There's nothing that you can do on your own to earn the God's grace and forgiveness. The only thing that will take away that fear is the grace that Jesus willingly and graciously and freely offers to each and every single one of us. And so the question is, have you accepted Jesus' forgiveness? If not, you can do that. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 says, "If we confess our sins, then he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." If you have received God's forgiveness, let me tell you in clear language, live like you're free. Because you have been made free, free indeed. Jesus has not only healed your legs, so he says, get up and walk, but Jesus has healed your heart and your mind and your soul. It's time to get out of the cage, that kennel that tries to keep you captured and caged together, and walk in freedom in Jesus Christ. You see, when Jesus sets you free, you are free indeed. But you may need to silence some roosters. Let me illustrate. Booker T. Washington relates a helpful story to us during the day his mom did this very thing. You see, every morning of his very young life, along with all of the plantation slaves, they were all awakened by the crow of a rooster. Long before daylight came, that rooster would awaken them. It was an unwelcome sound in their sod shanties and remind Brooker and his fellow workers of they had to get out of bed and they had to head towards the cotton fields. Oh, the rooster's crow, it symbolized their dictated life. It dictated all the long and backbreaking work that they were going to do. But then came the Emancipation Proclamation. And President Abraham Lincoln, he pronounced freedom for every single slave. And so the morning after that proclamation was made, well, that morning, Brooker was again awakened by that rooster once again. But this time, it wasn't just him making sounds. It was him running in fear as his mother chased that rooster around the barnyard with an axe in her hand. Later on that day, the Washington family had chicken for lunch. The first act, think about this, the first act of their freedom was to silence the reminder of their slavery. And I wonder if some of the folks who are watching today, if you have any roosters that are stealing your sleep, roosters that are stealing your peace, they're stealing your joy. You may need to sharpen your spiritual axe. See, the great news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that grace is real and that you have been set free. So, brothers and sisters, live free! Let's pray. Jesus, thank you, because we understand that the grace that was given to us came at a very, very high price. The price was the death of Jesus on the cross. And not just any death, but the most excruciating death. Not just the physical pain, but the point of being separated from His Heavenly Father, the only time in all eternity that that happened, as He absorbed the sin of the entire human race upon Himself. God, help us to see the high price that was paid, but the incredible love that God has for each and every one of us that would allow Him to send Jesus, allow Jesus to give His life on the cross so that we might be set free. God, we pray that our grace does not give us a license to sin, but we pray that when we do fall, when we do make mistakes, when we do disappoint God, that we won't become caged by that fear. They will understand that God's grace sets us free. I pray this in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. You know, we all have a tendency to wander from the truth. We all have a tendency to wander from the path that God has laid out for us. But I want you to remember and never forget, God continues to search for you. And He searches for you until He finds you, until He brings you back into the family once again. And besides that, He loves you. He loves you too much to leave you or to abandon you. And so, tether your heart to His promises, because nothing fosters courage like a clear grasp of grace. I would ask you this morning, if you need that grace, if you've never become a Christian, if you want to accept His grace, the book of Acts tells us how we find that grace. It's through believing in Jesus, our faith in Him, our trust in Him. It's through repentance. It's a turning away of our sinfulness, not only feeling sorry for those mistakes, but deciding in our heart that we're going to do and live a different life. And then being baptized, immersed into water. And through that process, through that plan, our sins are forgiven and we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Maybe some of you, though, have wandered off the path and it's time to get back on the path, to rededicate your life. If you'd like to do that in a public way, then reach out to me. Let's talk. Let's pray together about that. Maybe you'd like to become part of Cornerstone Christian Church. You'd like to be a member here. We would love to welcome you. Maybe you would like us to pray for you this day because you're troubled and you're in fear. Whatever it is, please reach out. I'm going to ask you to call me and text me or email me if you'd like to talk about a decision that you would like to make for Jesus Christ. I miss you and I love you, Cornerstone Christian Church. And I'm going to ask this favor. Remember that our plans are that we're going to try to regather next Sunday on August the 23rd. But it's important that I know a kind of an approximate number of those who plan to attend in person. So if you do plan to attend, would you text me or would you email me and let me know the people that will be coming in your family group? Depending upon that number, then we'll either have one or two services. Folks, it's going to be a great time to regather. I understand that some of you are not ready for that. That's fine. We want you to be safe, but we miss you and love you and can't wait to see you. Until we gather again, let's bring glory to God and people to Jesus. Cast your